invite you to turn in your hymnals and sing all the verses of the church's one foundation.
The Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, whose faith let us declare.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Good morning, everybody. It is so good to see you all. I dropped a card. We'll get to that in a second. I want to invite you all to take out your blue registration pads to sign in, to sign up for Wednesday Night Live dinner, to make your reservations. And for this week's Wednesday Night Live, we will be back in the Wesley Center because we got power. That's right. We all were in the office the other day, and we saw Bradley Flowers run by, and we all waved him down, and he got us going. So thank you, Bradley. Two weeks ago, we had our Commitment Sunday, in which we all filled out the pledge cards, turned them in, and we raised over 65% of the budget. And now Nathan has told me we are at the point where we have pledged past all that was pledged last year. So at this point, we are sitting already better than all of last year, which is just amazing as far as pledges go, considering all the time. And yeah, we'll clap for that. Yeah, so thank you for being dedicated to your church, believing in the church, even in this period of life, through all this storm and the holidays. So we thank you. On the note of finances, I've been told that if you're on the finance committee, to see Jim Watts after the service. He needs a quick meeting, a quick word with you. About 5 minutes, he said. On our recovery efforts, we have a lot going on this weekend. Nathan was sharing all about it on Facebook, and I had a lot of teams in here doing a lot of good work. Electrical work, more chainsaw work, heavy equipment, moving trees. All that is still rocking and rolling, so if you want to get that help or you know somebody who needs help, please let us know. And then we just ask that you be patient, and we'll get that work going as we get the teams in. UMCOR this week delivered a school kit for every child in Jackson County. Yeah, I mean, just there's just so much good things happening. And we're talking the other day about how can we thank all these people who have come to help us. And since it is Thanksgiving coming up just in a couple weeks, we thought next Sunday we would have a way of thanking all these teams and all these people who have come down to help us. I know many of you in the congregation have been helped or know somebody has been helped. So we were thinking we could either make a bucket or a basket and with some letters beside them. And next Sunday would have a way for us to write down and just say a quick thank you. And then the church will mail it to them because they have been taking time out of their jobs and they've been wonderful. They've helped so many of us and so much of our community. So we want to take the time to thank them. And we'll be calling and inviting all the people who have been helped in our community that they can come back and be in worship with us to have that chance to say thanks as we mail it to them. And talking about next week is also the giving out of our third grade Bibles, in which we'll be giving out 9 Bibles next Sunday, which is just absolutely amazing. Yeah. And then lastly for next week, Crosspoint, who has been one of the churches who have come and helped us. They helped at our fall festival, and they helped provide our meal on Commitment Sunday. They are coming back next Saturday, and they want to do a community Thanksgiving for us. So if you want to come have a good meal, we'll have it somewhere in the church. And the time is still to be determined, but we will have it in the Wesley Center. As we get ready to turn to the Lord in prayer, I just want to give you a few names to remember. Oh, and Carrie Eaton's also doing a community Thanksgiving, and that's Tuesday. So we've got lots of good things. What's that? That's 7? Here. Thank you, Carrie. Also in the Wesley Center. So yeah, we'll have some good meals going on next week. And as we turn to the Lord in prayer, I want to lift up a few names to you. Mark Vickery, June Mays, John Bryan, and Dale McDaniel. Let us go to the Lord in prayer.
To worship you, O my soul. gracious God, we pray for all those who are hurting and who need your healing touch. For the ones we have listed this morning and for all those who are on our hearts. We come to you waiting, trusting, believing, and knowing you will provide, that you will heal us and strengthen us for the road ahead. We have been witness to some big changes in our community these past few months, some bad and some good. God, we ask that you continue to refresh us, energize us, as we try to transform our community for the good. We know you are a God of transformation. You transform defeat into victory, despair into hope, death into life, and a cross into resurrection. You transform your people throughout Scripture. You transform us. And God, we pray for transformation for our community. Thank you for your constant love and grace that is in our lives. And together as a community, we thank you for your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We're so glad to have the songsters who are going to be leading us in worship throughout the service, but especially on this Veterans Day Sunday, we are grateful for all of those of you who have served, and we want to thank our veterans for their service. And as the song for your branch is played, we ask you to stand so everyone can greet you and thank you for your service. As you're able, yes.
If you're not able, just raise your hand. I am not able. We just want to say thank you to all the veterans through the years that have fought for our country, and we hope that this song will make you to have a special place in your heart for your country and your veterans.
Through howling gale and shot at shot.
is a special day for quite some time. Some wonderful folks in our church have been putting together the project of filling the rest of our sanctuary and education building with stained glass windows. And also, of course, last year we completed a long renovation, and there are a number of the things that went into that renovation that we want to dedicate and celebrate today. I know that the day of the storm, one of the first things I was thinking about was those windows, because they were put in the day before the storm. They were dedicated on Tuesday, and I was so relieved when Chuck Davis, who's here during the storm, sent me a picture and showed where the doors had blown in, and yet the windows over by the elevator were preserved. So we have a number of guests who are with us, who, because of their love of their family members who are being celebrated today and remembered and honored, have come to be with us. You are family, and thank you for being here today. I want to share what windows we have, who has given them, and to whom those windows are set, are offered in memorial and in honor. I also want to thank our trustees and our worship committee for their hard work in putting this project together. It's taken a long time, and it's been a labor of love. Mary Henson and Susan Coondy wanted to make sure that I did not single them out, and so I am not singling them out. They wanted to make sure that we didn't say that they led this effort, so I'm not doing that. So we are not thanking you, so y'all can take that for what it's worth. Amen? Okay. We have a new stairway that goes up to the balcony, and there's a beautiful window as you're approaching. As you climb those stairs, it's given in honor of John and Catherine Roberts by their children, Kathy Russell and John Young. I'm sorry, I've been a little emotional here lately, y'all. Am I the only one that's been a little weepy lately? The handbell room off the balcony has four new windows. One in honor and memory of Earl and Corey Paramore by their family, of Belent and Sarah Bell Pierce by their daughters, Sarah, Mary, and Charlotte. There are two windows in that room that have been given anonymously to celebrate faithful servants within our church, Bunny Wester and Bill and Linda Shack. There is one window in the central room off of the balcony that formerly had three windows that were stained glass and one that was not. So informally, we have been referring to that window as the OCD window. But that window has now been given by Jonathan, Julie, and Ellery Fuque to honor and memorialize their parents, Kenneth and Joanne Anderson, and Harry and Margie Fuque. There are transoms. The transoms are the areas above the doors in the sanctuary. The first one over this window has been given to remember Myris and Willa Dean Hughes Stokes by Jackie, Joe, Blair, and Joseph. This one over on the other side of that door has been given in memory of Henry and Marianne Burke by their children, Beverly, Beau, Bob, and Bess. And this transom window has been given by Charles, in memory of Charles and Ruth Davis, by Chuck, Linda, Richard, Mary, and friends of Charles and Ruth. We have a number of plaques that will go up to memorialize and to honor others. All of the work on the renovation was given anonymously. There were two large bequests, and there were a number of people within our congregation who gave significant gifts and all asked that their name not be shared. So this plaque says the 2016-2017 renovation of the education building and sanctuary was made possible by the generosity of members of this church whose love of God rests upon His foundation. There were there were two windows that were destroyed in the storm, and they will be returned. They were in the gables, the Clara story, here and here, and there was already a plaque made for those windows. The stained glass Clara story windows in the pediments were given in memory of Joanne Bevis Anderson by Kenneth Bryan Anderson, Jonathan, Julie, and Ellery Fouquet, in honor of John and Catherine Roberts by their children, Kathy, Russell, and John Young. Before the renovation, there was the Amelia Watson Chapel, and it was displaced by the elevator, but we have restored a room upstairs as the new Amelia Watson Chapel. The children will be having children's church for the first time in the Amelia Watson Chapel today, and there is work underway to improve the furnishings of the Amelia Watson Chapel, and so we celebrate the rededication of the Amelia Watson Chapel for the Watson family, the Reef family, and the Fossum family. Okay. Also, the cross and orb on the top of the dome was damaged but not destroyed. It had originally been placed by Charles Reef Jr., and it was restored by Charles Reef III, and it will be repaired soon. In the atrium, there are a number of windows that make a beautiful design consistent with what we have in the sanctuary, and there's a plaque for all the windows that have been given for the atrium. This is heavy. The stained glass windows are given to the glory of God in honor and memory of Betty Harrison Pusser by Bruce and Judy Harrison, Kreshel and Marianne Harrison, Margaret Ann Kresh Seal Ellen, Wayman and Janet Mooneyham, John Perry Mooneyham, Janet Mooneyham Booth, in honor of Karen Green Vickery by Kathy Russell and John Young Roberts, Anne Ray Hall by Trinka, Kenneth Taylor Stoudemire by Catherine Stoudemire Jordan, and Kenneth Norden Stoudemire. We're also rededicating the nursery, which has moved and been changed, rededicating that in memory of Miss Gussie Davis. Have I missed anyone? There's a lot of love that goes into this day, and there are centuries worth of service that go into the celebration of this day. We invite you to walk around after worship and see these beautiful windows. Thank God for the testament of love that has gone into these gifts. And thank you to all who have shared your love for one another and honored your families and the faithful servants within this community through these gifts. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, we consecrate these holy places, and these windows that bring the light of your world into your church, and are a sign of the light of Christ that comes into every dark place. Most loving God, without you no words or works of ours have meaning. Accept these gifts of our hands as symbols of our devotion. Grant us your blessing as we have consecrated these gifts to your glory, that they may be an enduring witness before all your people, that our lives may be consecrated in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We invite the children to come forward for the children's minute.
Good morning, boys and girls. Come on down. I'm so glad to see y'all this morning. I brought with me this morning something very special. This is Chuck's dad's army hat, Hunter's granddaddy, and Chris's great granddaddy's army hat.
And today on Veterans Day, this is a special day. Come on, girls. This is a special day because we honor all the men and women that served in our military. Now, Lawrence Nolan was a captain in the Army, and he served in World War II and the Korean War. Now, he's no longer here with us today, but this is the day that we nationally celebrate our Veterans Day. Now, we have lots of freedoms, don't we? We have the freedom to come to church and worship. We have the freedom to be whatever we want to be when we grow up. We have the freedom to live where we have a lot of freedoms in our daily lives, don't we? But I want to tell you something that might be a surprise to you. Do you know that freedom is not free? No. We have in this sanctuary today men and women who fought for us to have our freedom. Now, our songsters did a wonderful job. Made me cry. I'm kind of emotional myself, too. But I know that where you were sitting, you might not could see. I want y'all to stand up right here. And I would love for the men and women in our church to stand again so these young people can see the people in our church that serves in the military. Please stand. Look at that, boys and girls. Look at that. Even up there. Thank you. You may be seated. They fought so that you could have freedom today. And you know what? That's not the only freedom in the world that we have. The best freedom that we have is in Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that Jesus paid the price of our sins so that we can have eternal life. That's freedom. Right there. And when we have Jesus in our heart, we have that freedom, that, and we know that He paid the price for us. So today, as we honor our veterans, we should honor them every day, but today especially, as we honor those that fought for our country so that we could be free, let's also remember about Jesus, who paid the biggest price of all on the cross so that we could have eternal life. Let's thank God for our veterans, and let's thank Him for Jesus. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Dear God, we just thank You for our veterans that fought that we may have the freedom in this country. But don't let us ever forget to thank You for Jesus, who paid the price for our sins so that we could have eternal life. And all God's children said, Amen. Amen. And you can go to children's church today.
Let us pray. Dear God, as we offer our gifts this morning, may they mark our resolve to be more faithful stewards of the resources You have given to us. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Give thanks to the Holy One. Please turn in your hymnals to number 467. We'll sing all the verses of Trust and Obey.
Thank you.
reading of the gospel. Our gospel reading today comes from the gospel according to Matthew. I invite you to turn with me to Matthew's gospel, the 12th chapter, and we'll be reading from Matthew chapter 12, verse 38 through verse 45. Listen for God's word as we share it together. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But he answered them, "An evil and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster," I like that translation, sea monster, that's great, "so for 3 days and three nights the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth. The people of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it because they repented at the proclamation of Jonah. And see, something greater than Jonah is here. The Queen of the South will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because she came from the ends of the earth to listen to the wisdom of Solomon. And see, something greater than Solomon is here. When the unclean spirit has gone out of a person, it wanders through waterless regions looking for a resting place, but it finds none. And then it says, 'I will return to my house from which I came.' When it comes, it finds it empty, swept, put in order. Then it goes and brings along with it seven other spirits more evil than itself. And they enter and live there. The last state of that person is worse than the first. And so it will be with this evil generation." This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, please. It's not an unusual story in the Gospels for religious leaders to be challenging Jesus. And those religious leaders whose own place, their own job, their own position within their community is threatened by Jesus' ministry to try to prove that he's a fraud. And so they lay down a challenge before him. And they say, you know, if you are who you say you are, and if you are who all these people are expecting you to be, then prove it. Prove it with a sign. Show us a miracle. Give us some supernatural demonstration of your spiritual power. Could Jesus have done that? Yes. Yes. He could have done that. But he refuses. Why did Jesus refuse this challenge? Why did he say, I will not perform some miracle just to demonstrate who I am to you? Have you ever asked why God didn't do something that you wanted him to do? Have you ever said, God, you know, if you're God and you love me, then do such and such. God, if you can work a miracle, and if you love me, and if you are who you are, and you are what you say you are, will you please do this for me? Or I'm wondering here, I'm in limbo about my faith, and I want to believe. Can you prove it to me? God, will you prove yourself to me? Am I the only one that's ever prayed a prayer like that? And it would be so helpful if Jesus just said, okay, here you go. And everybody says, ooh, great. Well, to answer the question why Jesus refuses this request of these religious leaders, I want to pose a question to kind of think about, to wrestle with, to kind of gnaw on. I've been thinking about this a lot lately because I found this book in a thrift store about this big. I read these big books about stuff nobody cares about, you know? And it's all about the relationship between popular magic and religion in England in the 15th, 16th, and 17th centuries. I read 600 pages about this. You know, like,
Why do you care about that? But it did get me thinking, what is the difference between authentic religion, and true faith in Christ, and magic? And here's just one example. One example. So there were all these village wizards in England. And one of the main ways that they made their money is that people would come to them to help them find something that they've lost. They say, okay, we'll pay if you do your incantation and figure out what happened to my animal that wandered away. You know, and he put some bones out of where I can try down the hill over there, right? Or people didn't have banks then, so they would bury their money in the ground and then forget where it was buried. And so the wizard would help them find lost stuff. So that's clearly just superstition and magic. Amen? But when I get really desperate, I may say this prayer, Lord, please help me find my keys. You know, when you're looking for your keys in a garbage can, you know, you will pray. So, you know what I'm talking about? So it will look real clear that over here is the horoscope and the zodiac and the crystal ball and all the rest of it. But then, and over here is, you know, we go to the Methodist Church. I mean, we're Methodists, you know? I mean, how like down the middle of the road can you get the Methodist? But there are times when it's sort of like, okay, I want to know what happens at the end of the world. So I might find that from Miss Cleo, or I might find that from the person who tells me that the Revelation is going to tell me about the European Union or whatever, right? Yeah, where is the line? Where is the line between religion and magic? Where is the line? Where is the line between trying to figure yourself out before God and using a horoscope to try to find yourself out? Where is the line between religion and magic? I have been called to people's home to pray the ghosts out. I don't believe in ghosts, but but I know preachers who do. Where is the line? Magic is depersonalizing and manipulating. It is the depersonalizing manipulation of spiritual forces for personal gain. And the purpose is to use spiritual power as a tool to get what I want of the things of the earth. And sometimes it's the horoscope and the ghost chaser and the Long Island medium. But sometimes it's using religion to try to advance a political career or to figure out how to make more money or to try to get our career moving forward. If you go to the bookstore and go in the religion aisle, there's a whole religious self-improvement section, and it's all about how to use God, use faith, use Christ to get all the stuff I want of this earth. And these religious leaders come to Jesus, and they ask him to act like a magician. Show us a trick. And if he'd done so, if he'd demonstrated that he had to prove himself and build his reputation and use spiritual power as a tool to give a show, if he had used eternal things as tools for a temporary purpose, he would have undermined everything that he came to teach us. Magic is depersonalizing, and God is a God of love. And love is what's in this earth that we get to take to the next life. Love is eternal. It is grounded in forever. God's power works within the stuff of earth, through the stuff of earth. And so all creation is sanctified by the presence of the one true God who is God and will not be manipulated by us. We can't twist God's arm to get him to work for us, because God has given us that for free. We can't wiggle God's love out of him, because he has offered that without cost from the beginning. We get that from the get-go. And when the stuff of earth is lost, and it always is, everything that's of this earth is going to fade away. Have we learned that? Oh, yes. When the stuff of earth is lost, the eternal purpose that God had infused the things of this earth with through his love remains. The love is never lost. The relationship is never lost. I'm so blessed to be looking at my dear friends, Bess and Henry Hooks. I was one of their pastors. It's getting to be a long time. Let's just say I had a full head of hair and a flat tummy back then. And they have grandchildren now, but their children were in the youth group when I was working youth group down in Panama City. And I went to their church, my old church, Panama City First Church, yesterday. First time I'd spent some time in Panama City. And I sat down in the sanctuary, and I wept. I thought about Psalm 137, about those who'd gone to Babylon. And it says, when we went to Babylon, we sat by the river and we wept, as I thought about the destruction of the temple. And I helped pick the color of the carpet in that place. And the carpet's gone. And the windows are broken. And I saw the baptismal where I had baptized so many people that I'd prayed with to receive Christ, and it's piled in a corner. It broke my heart. And what broke my heart as I sat there and I saw the damage to that sanctuary is the remembrances of God meeting me in that room. The remembrances of the people that I love, and all those pews lined up, and I used to shake hands with all the church people before each service. I thought about speaking at the funeral of my beloved mentor, David Warren. It was a place where those connections were fostered, and that place is precious to me, and as we talked about this morning, it'll come back. It'll be as beautiful as it ever was. But whatever has happened to that building, what God used that building to do in my heart and in our hearts can never be taken away. It can never be taken away. I spoke to a pastor friend of mine who, just yesterday, he, like I do, he wears bow ties and he loves books. He's got lots and lots of books, lots and lots of bow ties. And just like me, before the trip, he was on a trip to Africa. But his parsonage was swept away, and all he had was one bow tie, one shirt, and his Bible. John Wesley said that he was a homo unus libra. That means a man of one book. What he meant was that the only book that mattered to him was the Bible. And my friend said, I really was a man of one book. Every book was gone. I said, what about your robe? The associate pastor put it in the attic. He's got his robe. He's got his Bible. He's got one bow tie. He's got one shirt. And his grandfather's ordination papers were taken to the attic. Everything else is gone. Our superintendent's diplomas are gone. His books are gone. The district superintendent's office, it was blown to pieces, and he put a picture on Facebook that said, the Marianna Panama City District office is now open 24 hours a day.
They were trying to get some paperwork on Matthew in the Dothan district for ordination. I said, you're not going to find that paperwork. You're not going to find that paperwork. These things are replaceable. And the way that these things are replaced will be a testament of God's love. And the things which are not eternal will be signposts of the love that is eternal. Are y'all following me? The things that can go away, but the love that is attached to the things cannot be lost. They're signposts of the visitation of the living God. The love of God that binds us together and makes us in us. In one sense, the windows that we've dedicated today are just windows. They're just windows. And we have learned through this time that we can worship anywhere because we are family. And where two or three are gathered, God is in the midst. In one sense, the windows are just windows. But I was so relieved when Chuck Davis told me that the windows were okay. And here's why. Because each of these windows is a signpost of the love of God that has been shared by people who gave their lives to share in the ministry of this church. Each is a testament of precious people who have offered their hearts to one another. I tried to get Karen to come. She's with Mark, and he's not doing well. I think about how there's a window that has been given to honor her in her ministry. It's one of many, many names that we call today. The many lives that were changed through her ministry in this church. Innumerable young people who gave their lives to Christ and found out about the love of Jesus. There's one name on a plaque, one window in a foyer, but it is a signpost to a reward that can never be taken from her. Religious leaders came to Jesus and they tried to get him to play parlor tricks. He said, one sign only I will give you. The sign of Jonah, who was 3 days in the belly of the sea monster. He says, I, the Son of Man, will spend 3 days in the earth. This cross was sent this week to Scott and Zip Fossum from Jim and Doreen Van Dyke with love. It was made from a tree that fell in their yard. Jim and Doreen came the first week, just days after the storm. They were here on the very first Sunday after the storm. Some of y'all were here, and we got to meet Jim and Doreen from Lumberton, Texas. As soon as the storm struck, they got in their car and they drove. And every day, they stayed at a hotel in Pensacola and drove back and forth every day, every day. One sign, the sign of the cross. The sign of the cross. One thing Christ gives us. He gives us himself. Jesus says, I won't play parlor tricks for you. I won't give you what you want. I will give you myself. I will give you my love. I will give you my life. That
is the only gift that matters, and no one can take that gift away. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Please turn in your hymnals to number 130, God Will Take Care of You. And as we close the service, I invite anyone who would like to pray to come around these altars of prayer and find mercy in this your time of need. Let's stand as we sing, God Will Take Care of You.
As we go from here today, may you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the end of day and all eternity. Amen. As we sing our benediction, please take the hand of the neighbor next to you.